Good afternoon, welcome to EduSet Network. Friend, as you know, this week we have organized a series of lectures on population theories. Today we will start with Malthus theories. And as you know, the broadly differentiated like theory like classical theory, neo-Malthus theory, optimistic and revisionist theory, demographic theory and post-demographic theory. We will try to understand all these in different lectures. We will also compare one with another and we will see the strength and weaknesses, what they have given. I will try to understand to different aspects of these theories. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in the studio senior scholar Dr. Abhay Kumar. He is associate fellow at Indian Institute of Human Development, New Delhi. And his area of specialization is population and development. He has presented a number of papers and about 10 research reports. And you might have heard recently a report has come on Delhi Human Development Report. He's author, one of the author of this report. And he's also visiting for faculty at different institute and universities like Jamia Millia Islamia University, Institute of Food Security, a Central Training Institute of FCIF India, and one important association like Indian Association of Parliamentarian on Population and Development, which gives training to elected representative at different level, like member of parliament, member of assembly, and also panchayat level. So it's important reason he is a member of technical advisory committee there. So I think his knowledge and experience will help us to understand the population theory and also the current trend and what is coming out will help us to understand, will guide us, and will give insight to how to study these things. So on your behalf, I welcome him for EduSet lecture. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Amrinder ji. Thank you very much. friends, I'm going to discuss various population theories that has been produced. to begin with, though we'll be discussing about the Malthus, but to begin with, let me start a discussion with how the population theories have emerged. First of all, I'll try to answer this question, and then I will also try to discuss the different kind of population theories, and I'll try to make a typologies of different types of population theories, and then I'll come to the different theories one by one, starting with Malthus, then Marx. So the first question is that how population theories have emerged. What was the need of why Malthus wrote a paper, why Marx has to say something on it, and why the new Malthusian perspective that have come on that. So the basic motto behind giving the population theories is basically to have an understanding of a balanced population and resource availability on this planet Earth. At times, scholars have felt that the population and resource availability on this planet Earth is getting mismatched, and that is why several scholars have, you know, felt, and they have written a lot, like, if what happens if resources, though as we know the resources are finite and population growth are taking place very substantially, in particularly in developing world. So what happens if the resources are limited and populations are more? How the population is going to adjust with this resources? After all, population needs resources for their sustenance, and then population, we should have as many number of population as the resources are there. So to understand these dynamics, population theories have emerged, and Malthus was the first person who gave the population theory. And though his population theory was criticized a lot, but still he was one of the pioneer person who has shown the concern about the rapid growth of population And then, after that, there are several scholars, his contemporary Ricardo, later on Marx, and then there are several other scholars which have, you know, neo-Malthusian scholars, neo-Malthusian theories have come. So there are a number of population-related theories that have come up in regard to the population theories. And if we try to make typologies of all the population theories that exist today, what we can do is that we can make 4-5 different typologies of population theories. The first typologies could be a classical theories where Malthus was the first proponents. We will also try to see in classical theories, we will also try to understand what Marx said about the population theories, what Ricardo said about the population theories. So Malthus, Marx and Ricardo, these three persons will be covered under the classical theories. Later on, the concern that was shown in the classical theories, which was particularly of a pessimism concern, that there will come a time when, you know, population growth will be so high that the resources will get depleted and there will be misery everywhere. That particular concern again came up during the oil crisis of 1970s when neo-Malthusian theories came up, in which people like Cole, Hoover, Paul Ehrlich, who has given the population bomb theories, Garrett Hardin's tragedy of commons, then Lester Brown has given their concern on the population theory. There was a Club of Rome which has given the limits to growth theories. So all these theories did nothing but try to revive the concern that was shown by the Malthus. So that is why these theories are also classified under the neo-Malthusian theories. But they were not. There are people who didn't, you know, accepted this pessimism theory. They felt that there are optimism available, and particularly Esther Bosrup, Simon, these people thought that mankind has got a technological prowess by which they can enhance the resource base to cater the need of the people. So they are the optimist theory, and later on there were several, you know, efforts by the United Nations under the International Population Conference, particularly the one that was held in 1974, then in 1984, and then we had ICPD conference in 1994. So all these conferences has again tried to revise the population resource theories, and they had tried to, you know, give the population theories. So basically population resource mismatch, balance has been also seen under the perspective of the underpopulation, overpopulation and optimum population theories. Basically this resource mismatch, there are societies where the resources are plenty but populations are fewer. So in those societies the population are called as underpopulated, the societies are called as underpopulated societies. Similarly, we have a societies where resources are limited but populations are plenty. So those societies are called overpopulated societies. We also have a society where the population and resources are almost balanced. So that is called optimum population theories. And this theory also propagate that we should have an optimum population so that the resources also gets utilized in a most productive manner, as well as the well-being of the people also takes place in a most productive manner. So these are the different typologies that has, you know, that has been done. Also, there is a very interesting theory which was one of the most famous theory in the population, is known as demographic transition theory, given in 1928 by Thompson and later on added by Notestein. This demographic transition theory has also, you know, tried to see the population with lots of different criterias, and then I'll come to these theories one by one in our other discussions. And then after since in the current situation most of the societies, developed societies, have already crossed the demographic transition already crossed the demographic transition stages. So now the question emerges, what happens after demographic transition stages? So in that particular case, there are theories being developed right now. There are, you know, scholars, they are coming up with several arguments, several theories, and now the demographic regime theory has come up. People are thinking to us different demographic regimes. So these are the different typologies of the population theories, which I'll discuss one by one in my other presentations following this presentation. But today, what I'll try to focus is that I'll start with the Malthusian population theory. As you know, friends, Malthus' full name was Thomas Robert Malthus. Malthus was one of the first person who has scientifically tried to give a population theory to this world. And his essay, which he wrote in 1798, which was called as an essay on the principle of population as it affects the future improvement of society, it was published in 6 different editions. The first edition was published in 1798, and later on in different years he kept on publishing new editions of his essay, basically adjusting the several criticisms and comments that came up on his first essay and subsequent essay. So Malthus, basically, what was the need that Malthus gave this theory? Malthus gave this theory to counter the arguments that was prevailing at that particular point of time, which was basically meant that man is perfect and it is basically advancing and diffusing knowledges, and it ultimately leads to welfare and freedom of future generations. So Malthus tried to give these particular positions. Malthus tried to counter these particular positions, this theory that everything will be all right and human knowledge, human well-being can be infinite. Malthus was not able to, you know, imbibe this particular factor. There was, you know, long-running sentiment in 18th century Europe that society as a whole was improving and that eventually perfection and efficiency could be reached. Malthus' father, whose name was Daniel Malthus, and his friend, his friend William Goodwin, as well as Condorcet and many others, believed at that particular point of time that possibilities of improvement of society were limitless. Malthus, somehow or the other, was not buying this argument. He was continuously, you know, having this thing in mind that how can this be limitless possibilities? And therefore, Malthus has to write his essay, which took into account the past histories of civilization. Malthus started his theory based on 2 postulations. He said, and I quote him, "I think I may fairly make 2 postulata. First, that food is necessary to the existence of man. Secondly, that the passion between the sexes is necessary and will remain nearly in its present state." Malthus said that these are the 2 natural laws that have been fixed, and these laws have been existing right since the humankind is there. And these 2 natural laws will even remain in the future, because these are the natural laws. The need for the food will be there and the passion between the sexes will be there. So, but what will happen if these 2 natural laws will persist? So Malthus basically made 3 propositions on this. He said that population cannot increase without the means of subsistence. Population does invariably increase where there are means of subsistence, and that the superior power of population cannot be checked without producing misery or vice. So Malthus has made these three propositions, basically saying that population increases as per the means of subsistence, and the power of the population increase is far much more than the power of means of subsistence. So what happens then when these powers, these propositions were there, then Malthus said that assuming, I quote, assuming then my postulate has granted, I say that the power of population is indefinitely greater than the power in the earth to produce subsistence for man. So he said that there is a direct relationship between population and subsistence. When population increases, the subsistence decreases, and when the subsistence increases, the population decreases. So there is an inverse relationship between the population and means of subsistence. Malthus gave his mathematical model to prove his point. So what he said, that population, when unchecked, increases in a geometric or exponential ratio. Subsistence, on the other hand, increases only in an arithmetic ratio. So Malthus said that human species would increase in the ratio of 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, and will keep on multiplying. So this is what is called as geometric growth. But whereas subsistence increases only as additive, say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So this is how the human species and subsistence increases. The first increases at multiplying rates, whereas the second increases at additive rates. What happens as a result of these two rates? Malthus said that in every 25 years, the population will get double. And hence, in 225 years, the ratio would be 512:10. So the population will increase 512 times, and the subsistence will increase only at the rate of 10 times. In 300 years, the ratio would be 4096:13, which is a big, big mismatch between the population and the subsistence. Basically, if we plot this geometric and arithmetic growth of population and subsistence, we find that arithmetic increases of subsistence has a constant trend line, whereas the population increases in a geometric fashion to give a J-shaped curve. So as one can see that the geometric growth of population increases at J curve, whereas the subsistence increases straightforward. So this is how the Malthus tried to present his arithmetic and geometric growth, and that is what it is presented here on the curve. What happens then? There comes a time when the carrying capacity of the society reaches, the population reaches to that particular point of the carrying capacity. It grows up after the carrying capacity. The place where population crosses the arithmetic increases, there is the population crisis point. And that from that particular point, the well-being of the human being declines. And then what happens? As according to Malthus, misery and vice takes place. And because of that, again, population declines because the number of mortalities in the forms of number of mortalities. So as you can see here, the population growth at geometric increases, whereas the subsistence is growing in a very flat manner. So there comes a point where population crosses the subsistence level, which is shown in the blue, and the red is population. And that particular point is called the population crisis point. And according to that, if a population crisis point is reached, then Malthus said that there will come a time when war, misery, and several other positive checks will happen, and because of that, the population will crash, population will decline. Now, this is what Malthus tried to make his postulations as well as theory. But to make his point, Malthus took the help of the law of diminishing returns. Now, what is this law of diminishing returns? Law of diminishing returns basically is a short-run concept. It assumes that there is a fixed factor and that the state of technology is constant. In the words of Malthus, I quote here, the improvement of the barren parts would be a work of time and labor, and it must be evident to those who have the slightest acquaintance with agricultural subjects that in proportion as cultivation extended, the addition that could yearly be made to the former average produce must be gradually and regularly diminishing. So basically Malthus tried to say that that the resources, say for example land, they are limited, and if one wants to improve that particular land, even if we put more labor to exploit that particular land to earn more means of subsistence, there will come a saturation point where we will have the maximum return from that particular land, and then what happens after that, whatever resources we, labor resources we add to it, the returns will decline, it will diminish. So this is what Malthus tried to explain with the help of the law of diminishing return. Law of diminishing returns, if we want to explain it, it can simply be said that adding more inputs to the labor to an area of land will not continually increase the output of land proportionately. There will come a time when the capacity of the land is reached and then diminishing returns sets in. And there comes a time when the misery and other different kinds of vices will appear. Now Malthus said that there are different factors that are at work in his population theory. And what are these factors? Basically these factors are, he said that in a situation of fixed resources, say for the example we have a fixed resources for of land, population growth directly affects consumption. So if more and more population is dependent on that particular land, the consumption will decline. Similarly, with capital as a fixed variable, the production per worker falls with the addition of each new worker. So the more and more new worker we put to that particular capital, the diminishing effect will start showing, which is also known as the law of diminishing returns. Similarly, increasing population implies a population with a large base of children. Now what happens because of this? The increasing population will produce a large number of children. These large number of children will be both unproductive as well as requiring a lot of consumer items. So these are the three factors that Malthus tried to explain. Now, Malthus in his theory, basically Malthus was favoring capitalistic system. Moreover, his theory particularly concerned with the agricultural capitalistic system. We must remember that Malthus was at the point of time in 18th century. At that particular time, the Industrial Revolution in Europe had just started, and the capitalistic form of production has just started. Malthus was favoring that particular capitalistic form of capitalistic setup of the society. Malthus said that the constant operation of the principle of population brings about the operation of the law of necessity. So each population that is grown, everyone requires a number of items for their sustenance. So the law of necessity works there. Now, this law of necessity results into rich and poor classes of the society. Now, as we know, the society has developed one after another. So, during that particular course of time, there comes a time when we started doing farming. Now, this farming started hiring the laborers. Now this labor hiring process has started two different systems of capitalism and a capitalistic system and the labor class, which we will try to explain in the Marxist theory. But here just to inform that this law of necessity made two classes of rich and poor classes. Now what happens? Rich accumulates capital but do not increase their population in the fear that if they increase their population, they will lose their well-being. But if they, you know, restrict their population, that means they will continue to maintain a better well-being. So this will this is how he said that the capitalistic society has emerged. Malthus then is strongly opposed to monetary transfers. Now basically this resource transfers, this particular point was made by Malthus to, you know, to say that we should not do the resource transfer, because the moment we do the resource transfer from the rich to poor classes, or we support from the government to the poor classes, then what happens? The money that will be invested in the growth of the economy, that will be hindered. And also those money, these monetary transfers will, you know, further make divide of the rich and poor classes. Now he tried to made he this particular point of, you know, money transfer, he opposed because of two, three different points. Firstly, he said that that if the capital was to be distributed among poor, it will not be available for investment on the mode of production. So his point was that the capital should not be distributed among the poor, rather it should be invested in the economy so that it should grow, and then the poor will get benefit. Secondly, he also said that increasing the welfare by giving money to the poor will eventually worsen their conditions, as they would mistakenly be led to think that they can support a bigger family. In today's terms, where the entire world is discussing about the cash transfer scheme and all, we must understand that what Malthus has to say about this money transfer thing. And that is why one can see here that Malthus was not favoring this money transfer or the capital transfer to the poor classes, as they said that this will further lead to their misery. Because what happens? The moment welfare fund will go to the poor, they will eventually worsen their conditions instead of improving their conditions. Why? Because they think that they can support a bigger family and they will grow more and more population. As a result, what happens? They will grow more and more poor rather than becoming rich. Moreover, immediately after such a transfer, people can afford buying more food, bidding its price up and decreasing real wages, which will further hurt poor. So what happens? If they will get the prices, they will, you know, afford buying more food. Now since there will be a bigger demand for the more food, so the prices of the foods will go up, and because of that, again the wages, the real wages which they have got from their labor, will decrease, and that will again further hurt the poor. So Malthus said that instead of, you know, transferring the money to the poor, what we can try to do is that we should restrict our family in such a manner that we should not exert ourselves on the resources that we have. So this is what Malthus was trying to say. So for Malthus, it is better for a family to foresee its lack of ability to support children before having them than to deal with subsequent disease and infant mortality. So this is what Malthus has to say. Malthus also supposed the waste factor in determining the population growth, which was also, you know, supported by Ricardo, and this particular factor we will particularly study in the Ricardo's theory. Now, these were the arguments that gave Malthus in support of his theory. And after that theory, Malthus said that to control population, we need to apply some kind of checks. Now, what are these checks? He said that there are two checks that is operative to control the population. Now, if these checks are there, they will try to make two unequal power of increasing population and slow growth of subsistence, they will try to mismatch the two. So they will try to make these two unequal power equal if these checks are applied. Now, what are these two checks? These two checks are preventive checks and positive checks. We can say that preventive checks are related with control of fertility, whereas positive checks are related with increase in mortality. Now, Malthus was supporting preventive checks more than positive checks. He said that the control in fertility should be done, but not by the way of contraceptive, but by the means of postponement of marriage, moral restraint, etc. So these kind of postponement of marriage, moral restraint, these factors of preventive checks will ultimately reduce the man's rate of production, and this will happen only when people will realize that controlling fertility can, you know, bring well-being to their life. Malthus said that if we don't apply the preventive checks, then there will come a time when positive checks will apply themselves, and these positive checks will increase the mortality in the population, and these positive checks can be in the form of vicious customs about women, pestilence, war, hunger and diseases, etc. Malthus said that, you know, we should not wait for positive checks to, you know, come. We should think ourselves, we should apply the preventive checks so that we control our population, and population checks, these positive checks should not get a chance to get applied. So basically, Malthus also said that these positive checks are more intensively found in the lower strata of the people, lower classes, the labor classes, where there are more infant mortality rate and more, where they live in more unhealthy conditions, and there the diseases, the epidemics, all this takes place, and then ultimately a mass level of mortality takes place in those societies. So Malthus says that the two checks will eventually close the mismatch between the level of population and the availability of resources. But as I said, the positive checks are at the cost of creating misery and wickedness that cannot be avoided and are beyond the control of men. So if positive checks are applied, then what happens? The misery, the wickedness to the population will come. So Malthus said that we should try to avoid this situation happen, and that is why Malthus emphasized on the preventive checks. So Malthus therefore suggested that it is better to have preventive checks than positive checks. What Malthus did not, give importance was, he did not consider technological improvements can also bring, difference in the life of the people. Malthus ignored this particular phenomenon. Also, Malthus did not consider migration could also alleviate the effects of the positive checks. Malthus rather considered it a possibility which is unfeasible. Malthus was not in the favor of contraceptive methods either. So even if he advocated for the preventive checks, he said that one should not adopt for the contraceptive methods. This particular, idea, it came because, as I mentioned earlier, Malthus was basically a cleric, and he did not favor the contraceptive, use of contraceptive. Rather, he said that we should delay the marriage as long as we can, so that we have the means of subsistence with us, we should not marry, we should not reproduce. But he did not favor the means of contraceptives. He said that there is a negative correlation between the number of children and well-being in life, which means that if a number of children are more, then the well-being in life will be lesser. And similarly, vice versa, if the number of children are less, then the well-being in life will be better. However, given this Malthusian theory, Malthus was also one of the most referred population theorists on this globe, but he was also one of the most criticized population theorists. There are several criticisms which challenge the different aspects of Malthusian population theory. First of all, to begin with, the relationship between population growth and production capacity has been subject to considerable criticism. Many of the scholars criticize this, that population growth and the production capacity which Malthus has tried to see, Malthus has tried to exaggerate the growth of population in relation to the means of subsistence. So basically the criticism was that Malthus made it so, this population growth, the Malthusian population growth was such a high that it is not possible to happen in any society. So basically Malthus was criticized on his relationship between the population growth and the means of subsistence. Secondly, there are several other mitigating factors such as technological development, agricultural developments, changes in societal organization, changes in government policies. All of these can bring, enable humanity to avoid a situation where the number of people was greater than the capacity to sustain them. So these are the factors which was completely ignored by Malthus. He placed undue emphasis on the limitation of supply of land. He did not see agricultural revolution. He said that land is limited, but though land is limited, but the agriculture revolution has shown that the limitation of land can also be overcome, and the productivity of the land can increase, and it can feed and it can increase the means of subsistence for more and more people. To substantiate this agricultural revolution, Esther Bosrep suggested that Malthusian argument displays a reverse causation. Rather than showing population growth affects agricultural productivity, Esther Bosrep said that it is the agricultural productivity that affects population growth. So basically, the relationship between the population growth and the means of subsistence which Malthus tried to make was, criticized by several scholars. Malthus' second assumption of diminishing returns to labor also did not hold true in the long run, as higher population may lead to more efficient division of labor as well as improved agricultural productivity. So this the law of diminishing returns can happen for the short run, but in the long run it is not going to be valid. Agricultural scientist Julian L. Simon also criticized Malthus by giving his reason that emphasizing the long run of basically Simon emphasized that population growth has a long run benefits. So what Simon tried to say is that he has given a simulation model, and which says that after a period of 30 years, what happens if a population growth is there, then it will have adverse impact, it will have positive impact, to knowledge advances and economies of scale. So basically Simon was trying to make point that fine, if a population is growing, then there will come a time when there will be a stress on the means of sustenance, but after a brief shorter period, there will come a time when the human knowledge, human technological development will, overcome these difficulties, and that population growth will basically lead to the advancement of the knowledge, advancement of the agricultural developments and advancement of the economy. So in the long run, one can see that population growth also leads to the advancement of the economy. The economist Henry George argued that Malthus didn't provide any evidence of a natural tendency for a population to overwhelm its ability to provide for itself. Similarly, there are several other criticisms. Another criticism stressed on the importance of fertility decision made by parents that was overlooked by Malthus. Basically, this particular criticism came in the light that, the fertility decision is a rational choice of a family, and it is a decision made by the family. It is not a decision So a family takes a fertility decision, and this particular decision was largely ignored by Malthus. Similarly, Baker and Louis were also the first to formalize the idea that parents may be altruistic towards their children when making fertility decisions. So basically their point was that while parents taking the decisions of, you know, producing children, they will take into account both the number of the children as well as the quality of each of them, so that they get a better consumption, so that they get better education, so that they get a better health, and all these factors also, you know, being considered while producing children, while taking the fertility decisions in the family, which was largely ignored by Malthus. Sorry. There are other group of scientists, say Baker, Murphy, Tamura, which pointed that Malthus analysis is not suited to the modern era, as it ignores the importance of education and the higher cost of raising them in the industrialized country. So it was similar to the previous argument that the current era, in the modern era, what we need is that we try to give the best and better education to our children, better health facilities to our children. And this particular fact was also, you know, raised by Baker, Murphy and Tamura, and they also criticized Malthus for not considering this point. Geller and Will also finds that population growth gradually improved technology. So there was another group of scientists which finds that population growth not necessarily leads to the misery. It rather leads to the improvement in the knowledge, improvements in the technology, improvements in the, you know, human capital. So all these factors lead to the quality of children rather than quantity of children. And that is why they emphasize that after a point of time, the quality of children becomes more important than quantity. And that is why family takes decision in terms of giving quality education, health, and other subsistence to the children. The ratio of geometric and arithmetic growth was also very severely criticized. For instance, Kenneth Smith pointed that these ratios were based on very slender foundation. It has no valid reasoning, and it was never really proved in the history of mankind. No population has grown for a longer period of time in the fashion in which Malthus was trying to make his points. And also the means of subsistence and the population growth, the ratio between the two also did not match the Malthusian ratio in any society in the history of the mankind. So Malthus was also criticized for his ratio of geometric and arithmetic growth. Similarly, the classification of checks, the two checks that Malthus said, that the positive checks and preventive checks, Malthus was criticized even on those checks issues. There were scholars who criticized that the two checks that Malthus propagated do not form independent categories, and also Malthus could not connect these checks with his theory. In the writing of Malthus, if you see an essay to the population, Malthus has mentioned about these checks, but in his essay he was not able to connect the two checks together, and that is why Malthus found that the scholars found that the classification of checks of preventive and positive, you know, they're not separate in a very distinguished fashion. Rather, they intersect each other also. So Malthus was criticized even on those fronts. His religious belief, as I said earlier, that Malthus was a cleric, and because of that he was not, you know, favoring contraceptive methods. So his religious beliefs also prevented him to grasp the use of contraceptive methods. So Warren S. Thompson noted that although Thompson, the person who has given the demographic transition theory, he said that although he lived till 1834, and although there were considerable discussions of contraception before that time, he never gave any evidence of recognizing the use of contraceptive. And that was mainly because of his religious beliefs, which prevented him to grasp that particular method. And that is why he prevented also to bring it to his theory. Eversley criticized by saying that he did not made any significant. So the criticism went to such a level that there are scholars who even criticize that Malthusian theory did not contributed anything to the social thought, which ultimately find is wrong, but there are criticism of Malthus even to that extent. Kingsley Davis, the famous demographer, he said that though admitting the doctrines of Malthus were empirically not valid, he agreed that they were theoretically very, very significant. That the doctrines of Malthus which gave was little, you know, more metaphorical, more exaggerated rather than realistic. But despite of that, Davis said that they are theoretically very significant. And why? Because Malthus was the person who tried to bring the attention of the world towards the issue of the population. And he was the first person who brought this issue. He was one of the first person who brought this issue to the forefront. And since then, the debate of the population resource interrelations came up. And those relationships further led to the development of different population theories in coming after Malthus. Kingsley Davis also said that Malthus mixes the moralistic and scientific aims inextricably. So at one point of time, Malthus tried to argue from the moralistic viewpoint. At the other point of time, if you read his essay, you will find that he tries to make the scientific interpretation of theory. So he tried to, you know, mixes the two, the moralistic and the scientific aims, but that led to theoretical disjuncture at several points, and that is why he has been criticized that he was not able to connect the two things together. So these are the things that Malthusian theory says, and we have seen both the Malthusian theory as well as his criticism. But at the same time, we must keep in mind that Malthus was the first person, as I said, who highlighted the issues of the population. And though he was a political economist and all, but he was largely considered as a demographer, and his influence on the theoretical development after him was so much so that his influence on the theoretical development was so much so that every scholar who came after him tried to read his theory and tried to either support his theory or criticize his theory, but must take the clue from his theory to support their arguments. So in that particular fashion, if we see that Malthus was one of the very important theoretician who presented their population theory, and even Spencer tried to take the cue of the their theory from the Malthusian theory, and this is how the Malthusian theory was very, very important. Now I will stop here. And I'll also invite questions from the viewers. I must tell the viewers that today I have covered the Malthusian theory. In my next lecture I'll try to explain the Marxian population theory, what Marx was to say on the population, and then I'll also discuss one by one many other population theories in the coming lectures. Thank you so much. Thank you.
So the main thing of the Malthus population theory, what is you just explained. So can you talk about, can we apply that theory to the present time and explain the population growth or the changes what we witnessing nowadays, that are able to explain the Malthusian theory or fail that. But we'll discuss this, but before that we take the question from the Itanagar. Yeah, good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question.
Okay, can you explain law of diminishing return once more?
Okay. Basically, law of diminishing returns says that, you see, just take for instance the case of land. Land is finite resource, and if we add labor to the land, what happens? We get produce out of it. So there, suppose an acre of land for producing crops in that particular land, if we have 10, if we need 10 number of people there, so the moment more number of people are getting employed on that particular land, what happens? The maximum produce that that land can give stops, and there comes a time that the maximum, after a maximum produce that land can give, there will start a declining of the land in the terms that the just think in this term that a 10% are dependent on 1 acre of land, and on the same 1 acre of land, if 15 people are dependent, now what happens? The produce that comes after from that particular land, that is divided now into more than 10 people. So what happens? Per person availability of the produce declines after a point of time. So there is a time when you keep on adding the labor to the resource, to the to the resource, to the land, and then
the produce is not as much.
The
as
produce is not as so there will come a time when the produce will be there. The more you add the labor, the more produce you will get, but there will come a time after that the produce will start declining. So that is what is the law of diminishing return in very simple term. And this law of diminishing return was one of the theory on which Malthus tried to argue his discussion on the population growth.
It is because of the overuse of the piece of land, or because of
the growth of the population.
Yes. Because the growth is increasing, so we want more produce from
yes.
the same piece of the land.
Exactly, exactly. So basically Malthus tried to say that the means of subsistence is limited and population is growing in unlimited way. So what happens, if I can show this this graph, if this graph can be shown. So
they show the graph.
So if this graph can be seen, you can see that the red one is the population growth and the blue one is the means of subsistence. So there will come a time when the population growth will cross the means of subsistence, and that particular point is known as population crisis. And after that, what happens? The law of diminishing returns starts. So okay. After that, what happens? You will get population crash.
Okay, we have another call from Itanagar. Good afternoon, Clay. Please ask your question.
Good afternoon, Clay. Please ask your question.
Sir, can you tell me the concept of money transfer?
Money transfer, okay. Basically, it is basically resource transfer. There was some advice, even in today's terms, you must have heard about the cash transfer scheme. It basically means that those people who are not able, who are not having their own entitlements, government should support them. So basically this particular discourse was also there in the time of Malthus. And at that particular point of time, Malthus propagated that if a person is poor, then rich should not give money to these poor. Otherwise what happens? There are different problems occur. Also the government should not give money to the poor. Why? Because the money that is transferred to the poor can be utilized in the economic growth. And if the economic growth takes place, then the economic growth will take care of the poor. What happens if money is directly transferred to the poor? Then at that, what happens? That poor will get the money. They will think that they have got the more means of subsistence, so they will start reproducing more and more. So that what happens? Their wages will ultimately decline. And if more population is there, then what happens? They will need more subsistence, and the subsistence price will go up, and which will ultimately again lower their wages. So this is what is money transfer called.
Okay, this was explained in the in the term of Malthusian theory.
Malthusian theory. Yeah.
Okay.
This was also explained by Ricardo, which I'll try to discuss in the Ricardo theory of population.
Okay. I think we have another question. Oh, we have call from Sagar. Yeah, good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question.
Good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question.
So my question on the...
Yeah, go ahead.
Related to Malthus theory, Malthus theory related to the Ricardo's theory.
Okay.
Comparative. Better we do it tomorrow.
Let me tell you, friend, when I'll discuss about the Ricardo, I will explain this, but in briefly I will say that Ricardo and Malthus, both of them had a very similar viewpoint, and I will explain these factors when I'll discuss about the Ricardo.
Okay. Another question? Okay. Briefly, if you can just in one, two lines, what was the difference between Malthus and Ricardo, if you can do?
Malthus and Ricardo were friends. Both were contemporary and both were very good friends. Both were English, and Malthus' theory of population, Ricardo has completely agreed with the Malthusian population theory. And Ricardo, besides this means of subsistence, Ricardo was, agreeing with what Malthus was saying, that population growth is taking all the, propositions that Malthus made. Ricardo was agreeing to those propositions. Besides, Ricardo also gave few other things which I'll discuss in his theory. But here I'll just say that Ricardo...
In a way, we can say that the basic principle of both of them was same.
Almost similar.
Ricardo
almost
only
similar.
Added some more
dimensions
to the...
Dimensions to the... Exactly. So this was there.
Okay, so when we'll talk about the Ricardo, the things will get
yeah,
more
it clear. Will get more clear, and I'll try to give a comparative picture of the Malthus and Ricardo there in my Ricardo's theory explanation.
Okay, so well, friend, I think you have understood the Malthus theory. We'll take up one by one the other theories, and we'll try to continue explain all these things today. We conclude the lecture. I thank all of you for watching the lecture. And on your behalf, I thank Dr. Abhay Kumar for explaining such a brilliant way on the population theory. Thank you very much.